Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's interesting that the opening message was about mediumship, one of these things that we don't plan, but it's planned from the other side. Good morning. And so today we're going to talk about mediumship, a work of love, and the intent is, for some of us, we may think, well, I'm not a medium, and so why does that matter? Why should I be learning or hearing about it? But the reality is that, well, one, we are all mediums. And so whether we are more or less aware, we are being influenced by the spirits, and we can become, the more aware we are, very useful as being intermediaries of uplifting ideas and helping others. You don't have to be an ostensive medium, one that feels the spirits, hear the spirits, because more often than not, thoughts comes to us who actually have been suggested by a different mind. They do not belong to us. Some great outstanding ideas that we may have might be inspired and came from another mind, but if we open and receptive, we'll be the mediums, the ones who will be passing that message on. So that's one way we can think about it. Now, the other way we can also think about it is in the context of mediumship in America. There's a lot of different ways in which we see it happening. And, and in Brazil as well, because, Brazilians love to find out about their future, and I'm a spiritist. I don't know. I go. Don't tell many people about it, but So what is it, right? Go where? Go to someone who's gonna read the cards for you, and I just want to see what's gonna come up and all that kind of stuff, right? Or I want to ask some questions to the spirit. So. In one way or another, this is part of our lives, and I think it's important, one, that we understand, we have an understanding for ourselves, and also to educate others. And let's look at what the Spiritism has to tell us about mediumship. So these are some of things that I got online, right, that some associations with mediumship. How about pet mediumship readings? And how about when you get a guarantee seal to, the service that's being provided, right? So how do we understand that? What does that mean? And this morning, as I was having my breakfast and reading my paper, as I do every morning, there is in the Miami Herald a column written by Dave Barry, I came to realize, yes, which is the funniest thing ever, and I will share with you if I have some time. Let's see how we do time-wise. But it's this is the picture that comes with the article, okay? This morning, I just kind of went back to the computer and added this to my presentation. So imagine that. Come to Conscious Living Spiritist Group, Psychic Mediums. We have five on duty today. Right? Isn't that something? Right? So what do we make of this? How does that work? Right? So we're going to have, maybe it's a service. Imagine we would have lots of people coming to our center. Right? For the ones who are worried how many physical, incarnate ones, we would have like lines here, especially if we put some very powerful mediums over there, right? To share information. So, all right. So, couple questions that I want to put for us as we start thinking about this. One is, what is the price? What is the tag that we put? All right, so you lost your child. I cannot think of anything more painful than that. And so, how much a message is worth? How much would you pay? What a funny, weird thought, right? How about on the spirit side, right? So, okay, I just lost my husband. We've been married for 50 years, or my wife, and now you know, whomever is the person is coming for a medium, and the medium is evoking that spirit, and the spirit's gonna come and knows that you, the medium, are charging their beloved one for a sum of money for them to speak. How does that work? It also seems a little awkward, right? And then, you know, if we are doing a consultation for material purposes, based on everything that we know about highly evolved spirits, and the very essence of the work that we're doing here, which is to understand that anything that is material is a tool, is a means and not the end for anything, right? So if we are in the work of detachment and learning what is the real value of material things, imagine the highly evolved spirits. They function very differently, you know? They have a full understanding that the essence of our life is not on the material, but on the lessons, on the experiences. And they understand that a lot of times the hardships have a purpose of enlightenment. And, you know, so it's a very different mindset that these spirits have. And so if you go to see, let's say, a psychic, what kind of spirits will be there to answer these most immediate questions that we have? Okay, so I made a little video for you because I'm now in the business of making videos. I make videos for my students, so I don't bore them with very long lectures. So I do short lectures and then post videos. So since I'm in that business, I'm gonna sit down and let myself talk to you.
Good morning. We are here with some absolutely fabulous news. We have here with us today a very special guest. Her name is Susana Simões, and she's going to bring us some clarity on some really, really phenomenal rumors that are going around. You probably have already heard about a guy named Allan Kardec. He is claiming since the 1800s that one, his spirits exist, two, that we are all mediums, and that we can communicate with the spirits. I know. You are probably freaking out about this in the same way that I am. But Susanna is here and she's been dealing with this Allan Kardec and these spirits for a very long time. So we are hoping that she'll be able to explain to us a little bit about these rumors. They are stirring our society. People are freaking out about the idea of being mediums and what does that mean and etc. So Susanna, good afternoon. It's so nice to have you here with us. Can you please tell us a little bit about Kardec, mediums, mediumship? I mean, what is that all about and what is that? Is it purpose for it? Hi, it's a pleasure to be here with you today. And so we are all spirits, and if you think about it, it really, really makes sense. Just like I took my jacket off right now.
Oops.
Oh. Oops.
Oh.
This is where it's the end of the evening.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm in awe.
It's pretty much what happens once we pass away. We just get rid of that heavy garment and we move on. And so the same way that I'm talking to you over there and I was talking to you, you know, the fact that we are with a jacket or without a jacket, we still can talk to one another. So yes, the spirits can talk to us. So a lot of times we'll have a thought and we're going to transmit that thought. And without knowing that that thought was not created by your own mind, but was suggested by a different mind. In that sense, we're all mediums because we are all under the influence of other minds. Your mind might influence mine, and we're here having a conversation. The same way we can capture other ideas and transmit the ideas. A lot of times we think that they belong to us, but they really don't belong to us. They were suggested to us. So again, in that sense, yes, we are all mediums. We are being influenced. I like to say we are walking out there under the influence of the spirits. okay? No. Why? Why? What's the purpose? Are we supposed to do something with this, right? Perhaps lots of money, if you can actually hear the spirits and, you know, you can open a shop and you can be like getting a huge line of people and giving them some like really cool information. I mean, that would be an outstanding business, right? Yeah, and many people do that. And then some people, you know, they like use the spirits and they like help others, for example. That's kind of a little bit of a different track, so to speak. So, you know, people do what they do. I mean, we're not here to talk about what others are doing and how they're living their lives. I mean, we're all free, we have a conscience, we have our own responsibilities. But here is where Kardec comes in place, and the teachings that he brought make the whole thing so special and so different under this philosophy that's called Spiritism. So, in Spiritism, we know that we have this ability. Now, it was given to us free, you were born with that, and so God is tremendous, and God is such a powerful force and a loving force in our lives. And so God is, when I say God, I say God's laws and the entire universe. God is really, really into the business of making our lives better and making our living easier. So God has given us mediumship as a tool, not to be commercialized, not to become a profitable way of living, because God meant for it to be available for everyone. Think about it for a moment. So there's some certain things in our lives and in our society, certain services that we study for, that we become very knowledgeable about it, and that we charge. So there are some services that people who are not wealthy or don't have the resources, they have to count on insurance companies. Let's say with psychology, for example, which is such an essential service for the soul, many people can get few visits only because they are limited to the insurance companies because they cannot afford to pay for a very good therapist. And I'm not here to talk about the business of psychology, but I'm here to say that mediumship is a tool of love. Is a tool that was meant to be available to everyone, regardless who you are, regardless where you live, regardless what you do, whether you can pay or not. It was given to us freely, so we can be freely used to assist others in all capacities, in all situations, in all ways of living. So now, let's also think about something else, right? I have a very good friend, and his name is John. And John is a dentist, okay? Now, imagine this. I'm a medium, and as a medium, my job is to go out in the community and find people for John to see. And then I find I'm really good because I'm very personable, I talk, I know a lot of people, I have a lot of connections. So I bring all these people into John's office, and John has tremendous amount of knowledge, and he's an awesome professional. So he sees all these people, they leave his office feeling a lot better. And then I say, well, I brought you here, I was the medium, you're gonna pay me. What? Pay me? He had the knowledge, he did the job. He owns it, it's his job, it's not mine. I just took you over there. I am a messenger. I am just the medium. I am not the one who has the knowledge. I'm not the mind behind the treatment. Same idea. Think of Edgar Casey, right? I mean, the guy used to get out of his body and be in touch with spirits, and then he would come back and he would tell the person who just walked into his office, hey, this is the treatment. Go ahead and do this. And people after people and after people, people who didn't believe in anything, they end up getting better. All right? Now, if he would charge, what was he charging for? For his knowledge, he didn't know anything. He didn't do anything. He just had the capacity, like we all do, to capture the ideas of the spirit. So the knowledge didn't belong to him. He cannot charge for knowledge that's not his. So in spiritism, mediumship is a labor of love. It is an instrument that God has given to us in order to deliver love, in order to make our lives easier, in order to help one another. Guess what? The biggest beneficiary from this work is not the person who you're helping, but it's yourself. Because in doing so, you are learning, you are growing, and you are potentialized and unfolding this tremendous amount of love that you have in yourself, and that is the essence of who you are. So I hope that I could, you know, bring some light, shed some light over this very complicated topic, but don't freak out. It's all about love. It's all good. Love. Open your channels, open your mind. Imagine that your mind is this really big window. Open it up. Let the sun in, let the voice of the good spirits into your head. Now remember, in order to communicate with the good spirits, you gotta tune your own mind to the high frequencies of life, so that in that way, you can be tuning with the voices that are also interested in love and in helping. And since we are mediums, whether you can truly hear or hear inside your head or hear in your ears or not, you'll be able to identify every single good thought that comes to your mind. And the spirits, once they see that you are truly, truly committed to help, guess what? They'll pair up with you. They'll make you and them an awesome team, and you're going to become a super instrument of God helping others here, making others' lives better, and also seeing a tremendous improvement in your own life. Thank you very much for having me here today.
All right. If you guys like it, Marcelo said I should start a YouTube channel. I would do that on my spare time. Maybe. But yeah, I did get into the business, you know, of like entertaining. I have classes where I'm teaching them about different types of Parkinsonism, and I pick up different chocolates and compare, and just, you know, life is too heavy, right? So we need to figure out ways of making things a little lighter. But, you know, that's the lecture, right? It's done, okay? That's basically what I had to say. But the gospel has actually a chapter that talks about it. And so let's look a little bit more in depth into what the gospel says. So it starts by saying, restore health to the sick, raise the dead, heal lepers, and cast out demons. Give freely what you have received freely. That's in Matthew 10:8. And the gift of healing the sick and casting out demons is freely given to people by God for the relief of those who suffer. So those are words of Christ, right? That sets the tone and is our main reference in Spiritism for how we should do things. And so he and the disciples, they have their daily jobs, and never, ever, ever any healing was charged or cost anything to anyone. And we all have this capacity. We can heal others with love, because we have love, we are love. So it's not something that should be a labor that comes with a charge. God does not sell benefits, he grants. And in references to Jesus says, Jesus expelled the merchants from the temple, thereby condemning the selling of holy things under any form whatsoever. God sells neither the divine blessings, forgiveness, nor entering into the kingdom of heaven. So nothing ever is charged in the spiritual center. There's no business in here. Prayers, any type of service, everything is free. It's a work of love. It's a blessing. It's a gift. And that's how we address it, especially salvation, right? How much money people pay out there to be saved. Okay, and the gospel continues by saying, do not sell words that do not belong to you, because they are not product of your personal conception, research, or personal labor. God wills for the light to reach everybody. To receive payment for its practice would thus be to divert it from its providential purpose. Okay. All right, so that's one of the ideas that I was talking about, right? So in mediumship, okay, when I cite Edgar Cayce, for example, right? Yeah, that's about it. So in mediumship, you know, it's like I was playing with John, right? We are just intermediaries. So whatever is being said, the idea that comes to us does not belong to us. It's not, you know, it's not my idea. It's not something that's being created by my mind, but by a different mind. So how can I charge for something that's being produced by somebody else? Okay, so that's the idea behind it. And the idea that, you know, it's a labor of love. So like I said, that God gave it to us so they can be not commercialized, but available to everyone, okay? And this is what makes the missionaries. They have never charged for anything. They give freely everything, the love, the prayers, the hugs, right? All the resources that they have. So even if we are not mediums, ostensive mediums in that way, we can also think about our lives and the resources that we have and the resources that we can make available to others, right? At no price. So it's important to go back to the concept of what characterizes highly elevated spirits, because elevated spirits are concerned with elevated things, okay? So what characterizes them is disinterestedness, okay? There's no personal interest. A spirit who is highly evolved does not work for his own interest. So you can think of any person who you consider to be very highly evolved, all right? I mean, what makes the missionaries is that they are constantly giving. That's what Jesus represents. Charity, love in action, constantly giving. He's the maximum expression of this constantly giving, so much so that when the woman who was bleeding for many, many years touched him, she's healed. She's healed by her faith, and she's healed by his fluid, by his energy. He didn't need to stop and think, I'm gonna give it to you. He lived in a state of giving. And so the fluid was always going out of him. The energy was a constant flow of energy towards others, because every action of his life was meant to attend to others. Okay? So disinterestedness. So if we are using any of our spiritual powers in a business, there is a personal interest. So that immediately, if we are attuning by frequency, we may have a medium spirit, but not a highly evolved spirit. Okay, we're gonna have maybe someone who knows a little bit more than us, but you won't be classified as a highly evolved spirit. Because highly evolved spirits don't work for anything. They work for the sake of work. They work for the sake of love. All right? And then all those who know the conditions in which good spirits communicate and their aversion for anything that may have a selfish interest, and who know how little it takes to keep them awake, can never believe the high order spirits are at the disposal of the first person who comes along and evokes them for the price at a mediumistic session. This is also in the gospel. And then in the book, What is Spiritism?, we find Kardec saying, one would have to have a very wrong idea of them, the spirits, to believe the highly evolved spirits, such as Fenelon, Bossuet, Pascal, or St. Augustine, would submit to the orders of the first person who show up and paid a certain amount per hour. So imagine a highly, highly evolved spirit who is involved with highly highly evolved activities, I sit down and I say, okay, Veronica comes to see me. I'm one of the mediums available for consultation of the conscious living today. And I say, I'm going to invoke St. Augustine here to answer your questions now. It's going to cost $100, okay? And you really think that St. Augustine is going to come from the highest spheres for $100 that I'm charging her to, you know, it does not work like that. The book Among Brothers of Other Lands, The Spirit of Horace Greeley says, we cannot forget that in the English language, we have abnegated spirits, mediums, at all times. They had given everything to the cause of truth without monetary reward. On their side, many others had the need for material support for the service they were called upon. However, we are forced to recognize the mediumship must be free, or the new revelation will be suppressed or impaired by inferior exclusive interests. So here I want to point out something important, okay? We are here in the business of speaking about the spiritist view. We're not in the business of judging or telling anyone whether what they're doing is right or what they're doing is wrong. For us, with our awareness, with our consciousness, and with our understanding, that's how we see not only the mediumship, but prayers, but salvation. This is all inner work. And we never put a tag on any of these things. Some people do, and some people do with tremendous amount of love and tremendous amount of good intentions. And one thing that we also know in spiritism is that intent is everything. So it does not mean to say that people will not be assisted if there is some payment involved. It just means that we should take into consideration the things that we know. Okay, so if a consultation is about material things, you're gonna have a spirit who is still concerned and talking about material things. So you cannot expect to have a very high evolved spirit because they are not into the business. They're in the business of giving hope. They're in the business of giving consolation. When we study the medium's book, for example, Kardec and the spirits, they lay out the characteristics of a message of a highly evolved spirit. So one of the things that we learn with Kardec is that the highly evolved spirits will never tell us specifics of what to do. Why? Because that would interfere with something very important called good free will. Okay? I remember many years ago, a woman who was part of our study group that I belonged to, she came to me and she said, I received a message from a spirit in Brazil who said that I should move back to Brazil. And I said to her, listen, no highly evolved spirit would ever tell you such a thing like this. That's one of the very first things that we read in the medium's book, is that the spirits will never interfere in our lives in this way. If you look at the messages given by Dr. Bezerra de Menezes to the mediumship of Givaldo Franco, all the messages that came through Chico Xavier, they are general messages. Usually they have a very high content of hope and consolation. And a lot of times messages can be given to guide a person in general ways. So, you know, reminding of like important values and things like that, but never, ever, ever specifics, okay? And in this statement, so he recognizes, acknowledges the worth and the value of many of our friends in America and elsewhere who do work for money and who have a role, have a place, and do in the best way that their knowledge and awareness allows them to do. But also he recognizes that in moving forward, it's important that we do this completely disconnected of any business and interest, self-interest. So here are a couple other aspects for us to consider, right? So if it's something that was freely given to us, it can be freely taken from us as well. So one of the hardest things with the business of psychic readings and those things is like, okay, I'm going to evoke a spirit here, right? And I'm charging you for that, okay? Now, what if the spirit doesn't show up? No, then what's gonna happen? You're gonna have to fake it, right? You're gonna have to fake it, basically. And so that really what gives rise to a lot of the frauds and a lot of the things that we see out there. It's not an art or talent, and that is why it cannot be made into a profession. It does not exist except through the concourse of the spirits. So you're opening a business counting that somebody else will be there to deliver the business for you. That's basically it, okay? So here, disclaimer. Welcome to Dr. Simone's practice. We'll be charged for the service provided by Dr. Felix Hoffman through me. You are committing to never sue me, since you fully understand that the content and knowledge being delivered does not belong to me. Right? That would probably apply. Okay. And here's some other thoughts that we read in the gospel. To put the concourse of the souls of the dead for sale is a repugnant thought. It is this sort of practice that is exploited by charlatanism, ignorance, credulity, and superstition. Okay, so let me, I'm gonna read this for you like very quickly, or not so quickly. So this is the article right on the paper today. And go back one slide for me, please, before we go there. So this speaks exactly about this last sentence. So here goes Dave Barry. He's writing a book about Florida and different things about Florida. So he says that he's at Casadena in Orlando, near Orlando, which is, he says, is the capital world of, the psychic capital of the world. As you get near it, you pass house after house with signs that say psychic. This is a place where you might have trouble getting a plumber on the weekend, but if you need an emergency tarot card reading, help is only seconds away. I'm having a read done by a medium who I will call Judy, a plum woman, I'm guessing her 30s. I arrive at her house and she ushers me through a kitchen to a darkened living room where candles are burning and New Age music is playing softly. She has me sit on a sofa. She sits on a chair in front of me with a small table between us. Judy produces a sheet of paper and says she will be writing down things as she goes, so I'll have a record of our session. She writes my name in large letters on the paper and begins talking. As she speaks, she often looks past me as if she's seeing a spirit I can't see. Sometimes she talks to the spirit. Thank you, she will say. Judy says she's seeing canisters and asks if that has any significance to me. I try to think of canisters that have been significant in my life, but nothing comes to mind. To be honest, I can go for months without thinking of canisters. Judy says it might have something to do with oil or an auto shop, and that placement is important. She goes on for a while, talking about the placement of the canisters, but it's not ringing any bells. I'm starting to feel bad, like I'm letting Judy and the spirit community down. Judy says she's seeing the number 76. I rack my brain, but all I can come up with is the song 76 Trombones, which is rousing show tune, but not one which I feel I have a deep personal connection. I shake my head. Judy says she's picking up something about bowling balls and brings up placement again. I shake my head again. I'm not a bowler. I'm totally failing at this. Judy asked me if I have trouble eating. I wish, I say. This is turning into a nightmare. Judy says she's getting something about a woman who maybe has something to do with race cars. I shake my head again. My wife happens to be a woman. She's a fast driver, but not of race cars. She's an SUV woman. I'm beginning to think the dead people Judy's talking to have me confused with somebody else. Then Judy says she's getting something about Turkey. The bird or the country, I ask. The bird, she says. I like Turkey, I say. Judy seems pleased. I feel relieved. Finally, we are getting somewhere. Judy says she's getting something about music. I tell her, I'm in a band. This is true. I'm in an author rock band called Rock Bottom Reminders. We are not good at music, but we do attempt to play it. Jude asked about the name. Ron. I tell her my wife's cousin's husband is named Ron. We are on a roll now, spiritually. We are 3 for 3. And he goes on, you know. And so he's like super incredibly funny. And but this is like, you know, this type of practice opens, right? Because you cannot count on the spirit. So it opens on the serious side, right? A space for this type of practice that do happen. That do happen. So that's one of the things that we don't do here. Now, another, I would like for us to look at this quick video.
Pode. Vamos lá. Vai, Espírito, escreve. Aqui, vamos lá. Vamos escrever um romance aqui agora, hein? Vamos lá. Será que eu sou canhoto na hora da mediunidade? Vou deixar mole aqui. Acho que não pode encostar nada. Agora é. E uma vontade de fazer xixi. Ó. Isso sou eu. Isso sou eu que tô fazendo isso. Sou eu que tô fazendo. Esses garotos aqui. Gente, como é que é? Vem, espírito, vem. Eu quero aqui o escritor, o espírito. A, B, vamos lá. Uma letra. Espírito. Espírito. Não vou pensar em nada. Tô pensando em nada. Tô com a cabeça fora da mão. Tô com a cabeça fora da mão. E a mão não tá mexendo, não. Peraí. Vamos no impulso. Oh, meu Deus do céu. Será que é caneta? Peraí. Deve ser lápis. Deve ser lápis. Chico Xavier, lápis, né? Ó! Desisto. Vem. Hoje na rua! Que susto, cara. Que é isso? Que é isso? Pergunto eu, né? O que você tá fazendo aí que não tá aqui no meu braço aqui, escrevendo aqui o livro?
Escrevendo o quê?
Como que? Um romance. Um romance. Vem, pode vir pro braço aqui que eu tô pronto aqui. Vem. Entendeu? Vem. Acho que eu vou.
Oswaldo, você não vai psicografar.
Ah, por que não? Eu não sou médico?
Sim, mas a sua tarefa na mediunidade não passa pela psicografia.
Ah, mas por que não? Ah, mas eu só consigo ver espírito, igual eu tô vendo você aqui. Que graça que tem isso? O que isso rende pra pessoa? Negócio bom é escrever, fazer livro, né?
O que define se o trabalho mediúnico é bom não é o tipo da mediunidade, é o médium. Se é um trabalhador disciplinado, disponível, aberto ao serviço do bem, isso é o que conta.
É, mas quem fica famoso, quem vende livro, é o médium que escreve romance, né?
Como é que é?
É isso, eu tô apertado. Esse negócio dessa crise aí me derrubou geral, meu filho. Eu tô precisando de um extra, entendeu? Então vamos parar de papo. Trata de escrever aqui um best-seller, uma coisa boa. Eu tô sentindo que você tá inspirado hoje. Vamos lá. Não, então melhor, melhor. Paulo Coelho já morreu.
Paulo Coelho. Ah, então é isso. Dinheiro.
Não, não é só dinheiro. Não é só dinheiro, não. Porque ela também fama. Prestígio, dá autógrafo, tira selfie, fã do livro que você vai escrever aqui agora, aqui, ó.
Já que você quer tanto escrever um livro, por que você mesmo não escreve? Pra que utilizar da mediunidade?
Ah, não escrevo, eu não sei escrever, não tenho dom de escrever, não é minha parada, eu sempre fui mal em redação, entendeu? Não, eu quero mesmo é ceder meu braço aqui, você escreve e eu gerencio a venda, porque eu sou bom de matemática.
Você acha que não dá trabalho ser um médium psicógrafo? Ele é apenas uma caneta ambulante?
Uma caneta rica, se for esperto.
É, Oswaldo, tô vendo que realmente você não sabe o que representa o trabalho de um médium.
Posso não saber o que representa, mas eu sei quanto custa.
Ok, então.
Vai escrever?
Eu não. Aliás, nem eu nem ninguém. Lamento te informar, Oswaldo, mas sua mediunidade está suspensa por tempo indeterminado. Você acaba de perder uma oportunidade de ouro nessa encarnação. Vai, vai.
Ei, ô, espírito! Vai, na volta aqui, não vai me deixar agora. Ei, menino! Meu Deus, se você não quer escrever um livro, a gente faz outra coisa. Você sabe pintar quadro? Hã? Sabe dançar? Ó, médium dançarino eu não vi ainda. A gente pode ganhar uma nota no Faustão. Hein? Se vira nos 30. Partiu? Uou! Deve!
I still have a little, So the Brazilians know this. This is a group called Friends of Light, and they have tons and tons of videos like this about many different topics in spiritism. And you can do what we just did, is we go to YouTube and you can put the captions to English and you can actually understand, because it will bring, so there's, you know, there's a few things that we want to correct, but you get it. And I think, you know, what can I say, illustrates perfectly the concept, right? You're counting on a different mind. He says, you know, you write the book, I'll manage the gains, right? So that's exactly the idea. All right, so to finish, I just wanted to, you know, bring back the seriousness here. And chapter 10 of the Gospel says, mediumship is something sacred that must be practiced in a holy and religious manner. If there is one type of mediumship that requires this attitude most completely, is the healing mediumship. Physicians provide the fruit of their study, which they have made at the price of often painful sacrifice. Magnetizers provide their own fluid, often time, even their health, and they may charge for their practices. Healing mediums, however, transmit the healthful fluid of good spirits and do not have the right to sell it. Although poor, Jesus and the disciples charge nothing for the healings they obtain. Thus, those who do not have the financial means to support themselves should go and seek resources somewhere else other than in mediumship, and if necessary, devote to it only the spare time they have available. Spirits will take into account their dedication and sacrifices, whereas they will avoid those who intend to use mediumship as a means for material gain. And from Jesus, I would like to finish with Chico Xavier, who you may not know, but he was extremely poor. Many, many times, barely had anything to put on the table. He took care of many of his siblings. His mother passed away with his father. He worked in factories. He made very little money. And so, those are just kind of little reminders of his mom and from the spirit Emmanuel. Emmanuel says, "Chico, no more than a dunk that carries important documents. At times, the ones riding the dunk will give it a treat, but the treat is not because of the dunk itself, but because of the importance of the documents it delivers." Kind of telling him what his role. So he was just a little animal transporting the documents. And what was the important there was the documents, the content of the documents, and not him. His dad, he's Chico, young Chico with his dad, and his dad comes to him one day and says, "Chico, I heard that the profit of the new book just released has been entirely donated to the benefit of other souls, but we are also souls. People are saying that you donated all the money to the poor, but I do not believe that there are people more poor than we are right now, and you could use at least one book to make money for us because we are very behind in our payments." They owe tremendous amount of money, okay? And so that's his dad asking him to take one book from all the hundreds and hundreds of books that they had, that he was a medium, and use the money to pay their bills. "Father, you should not think this way, because you know well that we have friends who help us, but I cannot take money from the work of the spirits. This is not possible. They do not allow it. We are in the work of mediumship with total disinterestedness. The books belong to them and not to me, and I ask you not to think about this. Do not worry about anything. The children," which means their siblings, his siblings, "will grow. Everything will improve. We are all going to work. There will be difficult times that we may owe others, but we will eventually pay." And there was his attitude, his entire life, and there are stories where he was like owing money, and one of his brothers passed away and he needed like, let's say $200. And then he's like, have no idea how he's gonna get the money. And then a few days later, someone knocked on the door and was someone who owed money to the brother who had passed away and was coming to pay exactly that same amount. So in one way or another, the money always came. He never used one penny of his work for himself. And so when you think of Jesus and we think of Chico Xavier, they set the reference for us in how we should and how spiritism asks us and instructs us to use not only mediumship, but prayer, healing, and all those things that, you know, we can use to benefit others, but also, and first of all, benefit ourselves. All right, so that's the presentation for today.